Amen. For our message, 2 Corinthians. Note verse 12, 2 Corinthians 3. Note verse 12 through 18. I'll read verse 17 and 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 12 through 18, but I want to read verse 17 and 18. Amen. Are you there? Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed unto the same image from glory to glory, even by the Spirit of the Lord. The word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. The working of the Spirit. The working of the Spirit. The Holy Spirit. In Paul's day, there was many individuals that had allowed themselves to be hooked on the works of the law.
Yes.
There was those who were so influenced that they would not change their minds about accepting Jesus Christ. They thought the Mosaic way was the way. And they was not going to accept no other way. But Paul had them to know that the law was only to help a man to know he needed a Savior.
Yeah.
And that the bullocks, the pigeon and the doves was not given to redeem the soul of man, but just it was a message to all lost people that they had a need for a Savior.
Amen.
And once Jesus Christ came, then that was no longer in force. Offering pigeon and bullocks, that were no longer in place. God no longer required them to offer animal sacrifices. No longer to shed the animal's blood for their sin. But it was the blood of Jesus Christ that made the difference. And so he encourages them to look to Jesus Christ and to trust the Holy Spirit.
Yes, yeah.
Because he's the only one that can give victory in a person's life. And the sad commentary today is that many professing believers, like the Ephesians believers, who had never had knowledge about the Holy Spirit. He asked them, had they been touched, had they been filled by the Holy Spirit? And they said, we don't even much know about him. We don't never heard about him. Amen. And every believer needs to know about the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You cannot live successfully without him. And he's the one that's in charge now. You know, no matter how smart we think we might be, or how strong physically, we can't live successfully without God. And because of that, we need the infilling of the Holy Spirit. You want to know that? We need the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And Paul made it clear that it was necessary that they would be filled with the Holy Spirit. And that they would know without a doubt that they could live in the fullness of God Almighty. Note Ephesians 3 and 19. The believers must be filled with the Holy Spirit, who is the Spirit of God. Also Ephesians 4 and verse 10. Believers cannot live this life except they allow themselves to be the temple of the Holy Ghost. Did y'all hear me clear? Every born-again person must allow the Holy Spirit to take control of them and to guide them, because he's not going to harm you. Amen. And so it is the duty of all believers, if we share the gospel of Jesus Christ and make it plain and clear, not beating around the bush, telling people just like it is, you got to be born again. You got to be filled with the Holy Ghost. You got to live holy. It's no dipping and dabbing. It's no amen, no ducking and dodging. There's no slipping and sliding. We got to keep pressing forward in the name of Jesus Christ. And living one day and then the next day living something else. But it's an everyday journey. In order to live victorious, you can't overpower your own personal desires that are ungodly without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And because you feel like it, don't mean you ought to do it.
Amen.
Can anybody say amen? Amen.
Amen.
And the Holy Spirit gives us power from within. And that the believers will know for certain that we don't have to live defeated lives. We can live victorious as the Lord has so willed that we should. And so as believers in Jesus Christ, we must understand that in order to do this, one must accept the gospel of Jesus Christ. What is the gospel in a nutshell view? Amen. He suffered, bled, and died. He was buried, and he was resurrected. And he's on the right hand of the Father this morning.
Yes.
And he's making intercession for us.
Amen.
We have to accept that with all of our hearts. And then we believe him, we love him, and we obey him.
Amen.
Did you catch that?
Amen.
You have to accept the gospel. You have to believe him. You have to love him. And you have to obey him. And these are truths that every individual must accept. No individual who will not accept the gospel teaching can be filled with the Holy Spirit. No individual, no matter how emotional they might be, they've got to accept the fact that Jesus died for their sins.
Amen.
Buried and rose from the grave, and is on the right hand of the Father, and is coming back again.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Every believer must believe that with all of his or her heart. If a person don't believe that, then that person cannot be filled with the Holy Spirit. And age has nothing to do with it. You don't get to a certain age and then you get filled. Amen. Whenever a person is saved, no matter what the age might be, that person must have the filling of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the Holy Spirit will not, amen, because if it's a young child or if it's an adult, if that child accepts Jesus Christ as Savior, then the Holy Spirit lives in that person.
Amen.
Did you all hear me?
Amen.
So you don't get a certain age, a certain size for the Holy Spirit to indwell you.
All right.
Amen. You don't get a certain age and then he comes on and fills you, amen. It don't work that way. He works when you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Did you hear me? And then according to Galatians 5, 22 and 23, the evidence of him being in my life shows up. He mentioned the fruits of the Holy Spirit. There are some fruit he bears in our lives when the Holy Spirit is in charge of our lives. Do you hear me clear?
Amen.
And so every person that's been born again must be filled with the Holy Spirit. Don't care who it is.
Amen.
Being religious and being emotional won't do it.
Amen.
Amen. Persons have got to be filled with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit fills individuals with himself.
Amen.
That's the second thing I want to mention to you. It is a call to receive someone.
Yeah.
The Holy Spirit is a person.
Right.
He's a person.
Yes, he is.
He's not something.
That's right.
He's not an it.
Right.
He's a person.
Amen.
I know what got a hold to me.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Amen. Ain't something I don't know what it is. I mean, when they wrote that song, it was all right for some folk, but I know what's got a hold to me. And I know his name.
Yes, yes.
And so the Holy Spirit, he's a person. It's not just receiving something, receiving someone. You want to keep that in mind. And the Holy Spirit is the third person of the Trinity. And the Holy Spirit directs our lives and guides our lives. And the Holy Spirit, he enabled us when we yield to him like a sponge that absorbs water. Amen. When we give over to him, he takes our life completely.
Amen.
And then like a well, he fills us.
All right.
And then, amen, like a bucket thrown into a well, when you drop it down into the water, if you know about drawing water, and the bucket go down into the water, amen, you pull it back up, it's full of water. Amen. We have to lose ourselves in the Lord Jesus Christ so the Holy Spirit can have full control of our lives. And then as a river, amen, this well that turns to a river that springs up in our lives, the Holy Spirit will enable us to help others. Amen. Am I coming through clear?
Amen.
So the Holy Spirit fills us, we overflows, and then he gives us victory continually in our lives. And others will know we are filled.
Amen.
And the person that haven't accepted Jesus Christ has some other stuff in them.
Amen.
And nobody can be filled with the Holy Spirit having anything in them that's dominating, ruling their lives other than God's will.
Amen.
Anything that's controlling a person's life that's not of God, the Holy Spirit won't endorse it.
Amen.
So it's a person that we receive. Do you hear me?
Amen.
It is our duty to receive him. You remember what Paul says? Turn to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5. The Holy Spirit wants to help each one of us to live victorious. You can't do it by yourself. You cannot deny yourself without him. And Jesus says, if any man will come after me, or any person will come after me, let him deny himself. Take up his cross daily, not just on Sunday, not just when they are well or when they are sick. You know, people can talk loud and strong when they're sick. Or they get into a situation that they can't get out and they feel they need God. They can talk strong then. And as soon as they get from under that, I've seen it. Individuals say, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this when I get out of here. I'm going to serve the Lord. They get out of there, may come to church one time. And after that, they're going back their merry way. Amen. But we need God every day of our life. And because you're doing good, you feel good physically, you can see good, you can walk good. Amen. You keep in mind, amen, it may not be that way always. So praise him for what you have now. And give yourself to the Holy Spirit. Because he wants to use you to help somebody. Here's something else. You cannot be selfish and be filled with the Holy Spirit. You cannot be dominant in attitude and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Because he's the only one who should be ruling in your life. Now, if you're going to be dominant, that means you're going to be in charge. I heard one, that's right, I believe. You know, some people just have the tendency to want to boss. Is there any husband in here know that? Now, if your wife is in here, I can understand you not saying nothing. I understand that.
Yes, sir.
But they just have a tendency. I've been married 8. This year will be 53 years. The wives have a tendency sometimes to want to boss you. Amen. But it will work with it.
No.
But you have to be nice, and you know, and just say, this is what the Lord said. Amen. No. Let me ask you that. Is there any wife here ever tried to be a boss?
No.
Got one.
Amen.
But then the scripture said, when you learn better, you do better. Can anybody say amen?
Amen.
You learn better.
More than one.
And some have created problems for themselves because they won't let go.
That's it.
Let me bring this in. If you have an unsaved husband, don't be trying to boss him.
That's it.
Don't always be the one that's talking. Listen to him. I thought I'd just toss that in, amen. Because the Holy Spirit uses that.
Yeah.
And none of us know exactly and everything we ought to be doing, but he teaches us.
That's right. Right.
Do y'all believe that?
Yeah.
And when you get to that point, amen, you say, Lord, just help me with this now.
Right.
And then the Holy Spirit helps you. Amen. God has an order, is that right?
Amen.
For the family, the order for marriages. Amen. I see a lot of smiles out here. Am I knocking on somebody's door? Amen. Well, that's the way to be, amen. And I thank God for helping me to be a good husband and a strong leader for my family. Amen. I thank him for that. Do you thank him for that, bro?
Amen.
I thank for that. And that does not mean that they're going to do everything just the way you want it done. Even though you're strong, but that's why you're strong. That's why you're strong, to help them that are weak. You know, the strong ought to help bear the infirmities of the weak.
Amen.
Is that what the Bible teaches?
Amen.
And we have to learn how to do that in a gentle way, in a nice way. That's where the Holy Spirit works. That's where he works. So we can't be selfish. We cannot be dominant. We can't be bossy if we want the Holy Spirit to have his way. Husbands can't rule with iron hand. I'm the man that wear the pants in this house. You do what I say or else. Amen. So we have to rule with love.
That's it.
Amen. Yes, rule with love. Let's rule with love. And the Holy Spirit guides us to do the things God would have us to do in the rule book. Do you know what the rule book is?
Yes.
The Bible.
Yes.
Sometimes others are not doing what they ought to do because they don't have an example before them. Did you hear me?
Yes.
Sometimes they don't have a good example. The person that should be an example is always critical. Did you hear me? Can't be critical. Amen. Don't go back home and tell your husband you should have been there to hear the pastor. He was talking about you. Don't do that.
All right.
He may never come to church. don't make him think that I'm his enemy. Receive the word, get it into your spirit, and then show him the way.
That's it.
Amen, Pastor.
Amen. Show him the way then. And just love him. The Holy Spirit will have you to just love him. be nice to him. Well, he no, just love him. Because then when you look at, as you look at your life and I look at my life, I remember where I used to be. I haven't been saved all my life. And the Lord was patient with me. Is that right? He was merciful to me. And he brought me on in, amen. And the only way to do it is by love. The Holy Spirit uses us to help him. And here's how you got to do it. Look at Ephesians 5 now. Paul writes into the Ephesians. And he's just touching on some of what I just touched on. Look at verse 15. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. If the devil can cause any person to be in the famine, to snapping at each other, or in the church, being bitter with each other, cutting each other down with words, trying to out-talk each other, amen. Just won't let nobody have the last word. Just got to have the last. Gonna keep talking, and if it's negativity, it's going to hurt the relationship. Yeah. Paul was writing to the believers now. He said, but if you don't control your tongue, if you snapping at each other, then you can't become what God wants you to be. Amen. Look at verse 16. Verse 16, this I say then. Ephesians 5 and 16.
That's not
correction. I'm looking, but I'm looking at the wrong chapter. I was really just reciting. Good to be able to recite, isn't it? looking at Galatians. That's what I'm saying. I said Ephesians, didn't I?
Yes, sir.
I'm coming. Galatians 5, that was 15, is that right? By biting. 16 said, this I say then, walk in who? And ye shall not. The flesh works against the Holy Spirit. The flesh works against the Holy Spirit. There's a warfare going on in you. And the flesh works against the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is trying to cause you to become what God wants you to be. But he said, walk in him. And you, Amos 3 and 3 say, you can't walk with a person or with another except you be in agreement. How can two walk together except there be an agreement? Are you there? Walk in the spirit and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. That's the totality of the flesh. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit wants to enable each one of us to live victorious every day.
Amen.
Verse 17. For the flesh lusteth against who? And the spirit against the flesh. There's a warfare going on. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. Amen. There's a battle going on. Have you realized that? Every day of your life is a battle going on. Your flesh want to do stuff it got no business doing. But the Holy Ghost gives us power. Looking at verse 18. But if... Did I read verse 17? Verse 18. But if ye be led of the Spirit, you're not under what? You're not under the law. Now, Ephesians 5 and 18. Ephesians 5 and 18. Are you there? Again, he contrasts here. how a person feels when they get drunk off of liquor.
All right.
Alcohol. Drugs. And be not drunk with wine. He's talking to believers. He's talking to folk who say, I know the Lord. But he's telling them, because at Ephesus there were some rough activities going on, he's saying to them, don't be drunk with wine, because they understood how you feel, how you act when you get drunk with wine. Did y'all hear me? Somebody said, well, all right, take a little nip. A little nip leads to a big nip. And instead of Paul said being filled with drunk with wine, people, there are many who think they can be really, victorious if they get a little high. They can sing better. I told the brothers, and I believe Thursday night, I was in revival down in Macomb years ago, and I got a little hoarse, and the pastor told me, who was a senior, that was, wasn't too good. He says, I got something to help you, but it's some narcotics in it. I said, no. Because it don't take but a little this, little that, and you get hooked.
Amen.
Yes, sir. Yeah, yeah.
Only thing I want to be addicted to is the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Did y'all hear me?
Amen.
Amen. Because I know about this matter of getting drunk with wine. I know about that. Amen. And I won't deceive myself in believing, well, if you get you just a good little shot, you really can turn them out on Sunday morning. Good hope. Just, they got these little ball. They get you a little ball and just get you a shot. And man, when you come out, you can really get it then, man. But I don't want the liquor to be talking. I want the Holy Ghost to be speaking.
Yeah.
And that I've been known down through the years. I've known some, and that stuff killed them. Amen. I'm not saying we got nobody members of this church like that. Amen. And because I believe you know that you mean what you're doing. Amen. So he says, I heard somebody say a nip. Be not drunk with wine. You know, God has me on an elevated level. Now I hear you, this congregation. If you say something that others can hear, I can hear it. Not that you said something bad, I'm just letting you know that. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is the excess, but be filled with who?
Spirit.
Be filled with the Spirit. That's the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Now, why is he telling us that? He said, I'm saved, and the Holy Spirit already lives in me. Being filled means you have to yield to him. That's control, amen. Because you wouldn't be saved without the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Anybody tell you that you can get saved and get the Holy Ghost later, they don't know what they're talking about. You don't get saved here and then go somewhere else and get the Holy Ghost. Now I heard my uncle told me, he said, well, Rip, your members don't have to know it. You just come on up here and go down in the name of Jesus and get the Holy Ghost and then go on back to your church. I said, oh, no, uncle. Now he believed that. He believed that Baptists don't have the Holy Spirit. Oh yeah, they believe that.
The
movement that he was in, they believe that. Baptists don't have it. Of course, I've been a pastor for years then. He says to me, Reb, your members don't have to know it.
Yeah.
Just come on up here and go down in the name of Jesus Christ only and get the Holy Ghost. And then go on back to your church. You can't be saved without the Holy Ghost. When I got saved, amen, through Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit took a resident in my life. Amen. I didn't run down in the woods nowhere either. It's a change that comes on the inside of you, and he takes charge as you yield to him. supposed to be filled with him. Everybody need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Do y'all believe that? Everybody need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, because without the filling of the Holy Spirit, nobody can live victorious. Amen. Every person needs to be filled with who? Okay, now as you look at the scriptures again, I'm gonna point out something to you. Again, Paul is writing to the Corinthian believers that have a problem with understanding the role of the law and the role of the gospel. All right. The gospel, the good news.
Right.
That's what the gospel means, good news.
Right.
It's the evangel.
All right.
Amen.
All right.
It brings about a change in a person's life.
Yeah. Yeah.
Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power of God to salvation to everyone that believes. That's Romans 1:16. Now look at the text scriptures. Believers today have got to lean to the Holy Spirit. They got to yield to his power. Because there's so many have been deceived down through the years. The Holy Spirit is the only one who can help us to live victorious. Catch this. He never fails us to shout.
Yes, sir.
No. He never fails us to be emotional and get all stirred up. Not that we don't get happy now. His main purpose in filling us is to help us to serve God.
Amen.
To stand before people that's mean.
All
right. On your job and in your family. Holy Spirit fills you so when you talk about Christ, you won't get discouraged when others turn you down.
All right.
Or somebody cuss you out. Say, I don't want nothing to do with that God you're talking about. Then you won't get offended. You say, well, I'm going to be praying for you continually. You don't get upset, you don't discourage, say, well, I'm not going to witness no more then. Go to the next one. My granddad would say it like this, there's more than one fish in the sea. So if you don't catch one, catch another one. Go. So the word says here, now the Lord, Paul is making known to them, that's verse 17, now the Lord is that spirit. You see that? Is that spirit. Now the Lord is that spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there's what?
Liberty.
Why is it that so many believers abound? Did you hear me? Why is there so many believers abound? I mean, they got habits they can't put down. They're hooked on this and hooked on that. And yet they profess to know Jesus Christ. But wherever the spirit is, somebody ought to say that there is liberty. He gives you freedom. He gives you power over whatever the devil brings to you to bind you. You remember that man that was living in the cemetery? Cutting himself with stones. You remember when he accepted the Lord? You know what happened, don't you? The Lord made him, he set him free, didn't he? And he was clothed and in his right mind. So wherever the spirit of the Lord is, there is what? Liberty. No believer should allow himself or herself to be in bondage. To anything. If there's something controlling you other than the Holy Spirit, you'll never live victorious as a Christian. Because the Holy Spirit gives you power over yourself. And everybody may not be nice to you.
Amen.
But the Holy Spirit will anchor you and strengthen you. Look what happened. Look what happened. Jesus in the wilderness. Jesus when he was tempted. You remember that?
Amen.
You remember when he stood his ground in God's will? And the Bible said, he said, get behind me, Satan. Did he leave?
Yes.
And the angels came and ministered to him.
Amen.
Do y'all hear me? They were watching.
Yeah.
And when we are being tempted and tested, amen, God's heavenly host watches us. You get through, you pass the test, they give you power to go to the next. Don't ever think because you overcome one challenge that that's it. When you go over one hurdle, it just prepare you for the next hurdle. And sometimes they're higher. But he who gives you power to jump over a low hurdle can give you power to jump over a high hurdle. Do you remember what David says? David says, he give me power to leap over a wall. And then if there's a troop set up above me, I'd go through them. God gives us power, but you have to allow him to do that.
Amen.
I'm going to touch on a few other things. Right? So the Holy Spirit is a person. It's not just something we receive. It's someone that we receive. And many believers are missing out and going to miss out on the abundant life that Jesus made available. Many believers will be professing on this earth to live and die without enjoying the life that Christ has given to the full. Because they're not aware of how the Holy Spirit operates.
Oh, yeah.
He's not going to be jumping over stuff.
That's right.
Amen.
All right.
He's not going to be jumping over stuff. Amen. Everybody that's around you need to know who you that you're who you profess to be.
That's right.
Amen.
If they're negative, they ought to know.
Oh, yeah.
Because light is different from darkness. Is that right? So the word says that the Holy Spirit helps us to be free and not be in bondage. Now come on, go away. I'm going back to Pastor. The Holy Spirit just brought to him. Turn to Luke. Hold there and that close the verse. Luke 9. Do y'all believe the Bible?
Amen.
Do you believe God is real?
Yes.
Do you believe Jesus is real?
Yes.
Do you believe the Holy Ghost is real?
Yes.
Do you believe his power and authority is over all power and authority?
Yes.
Come on, you can give that another hand. You can give it another hand, amen. Luke 9, looking at starting verse 1 and 2. Look what he says. Then he, that's Jesus,
yes,
called his disciples. You said, well, they're gone, but he left it on record for us. Then he, Jesus, called his 12 disciples together and gave them what?
Power.
An authority.
All devils.
And to cure diseases. God still will use us to pray for people and they get healed.
All right.
Everybody may not be healed, but he can use us to do it if we yield to him.
Right.
Look at verse 2. And he sent them to preach what?
The kingdom of God.
What is the kingdom of God? What is the definition of the kingdom of God according to the scripture? Righteousness and peace and joy and who? That's Romans 14:17. Okay. So he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to do what? Heal the sick. Amen. Do you believe God still can do it?
Amen.
The gospel bring about a change. That is good news. The good news is nobody has to remain lost. Nobody has to remain in their and the condition they're in that they can't get through life, it seems. Nobody has to remain in that condition. The gospel of Jesus Christ gives people freedom and liberty over all of their trials and tribulation in life by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Anybody about ready to ask the question? When is the pastor going to preach? Pastor's preaching now. It's time out for our people being deceived.
Amen.
And believing that if a preacher don't hoop and holler, he's not preaching. It's the knowledge and understanding.
Amen.
Did y'all hear me?
Amen.
And let me tell you, I've gotten happy just reading the Bible. I have shed tears just reading the scripture.
Amen.
I've been encouraged at reading a book that's on the Bible that's written by a spiritual author and got encouraged. The Holy Ghost does that. Let me pick out a few more things. So there's liberty wherever the Spirit of the Lord is. If it's in your house, if he's in your life, the devil can't bind you. You can tell him, get away from me with your ugly self. And the Bible says in Matthew, you can't break in a strong man's house except you first bind the strong man. He'll destroy your life if he can break in your life.
Yes, he will.
But you have to be firm. As men and women, boys and girls, you have to be firm. You say, no, the Lord didn't say that. The Lord told me to do this. The Lord told me to do that. And this is what I'm going to do. You know, you one of those old Christians. Yes, you sure right. Because see, they used that as a slur back in those days. Now those old Christians, that's a slur back then, see. But I'm happy to be a Christian.
Amen.
Anybody else happy?
Amen.
I'm happy to be a Christian. Here's this text verse, this closing text verse. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. You can see just enough to help you now. And are changed into what? Are changed into the same. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah. Are you getting that? Changed in the same image of God's Son. Turn to Romans 8:29. Image takes me there, Romans 8. If you beat me there, say, I got it, Pastor.
Amen.
I heard one. I heard two. Romans 8:29. He said, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be what? Conformed to the image of his Son. Somebody ought to shout hallelujah, amen. So Paul writes to the Ephesians to help them understand you can't do it by the works of the law. It's got to be by the gospel of Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit. It got to be the Lord's Spirit. Some people brag on having the Spirit, but they need to be sure it's the right Spirit. Because you have a spirit yourself.
Amen.
And then there's an evil spirit. And then there's the Holy Spirit. Now, what spirit is controlling your life? That's the question. So he says that we are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. We cannot be changed by our own power. But the Holy Spirit works in us to help us to become conformed to the image of God's Son. Philippians 1:6. And he who has begun in you will perform it unto who? Here's this, and I want you to turn and look at this one. Ephesians 3. Now Philippians 1:6, that's the first one. I traveled fast now. Philippians 1:6, and he who has begun a good work in us will perform it unto the day of Christ. Is that right? That's Philippians 1:6. Now, turn to Ephesians. What did I say?
3.
Ephesians 3:20. So the power of the Holy Spirit is in you. He has begun a good work in you will perform it unto the day of Christ. The Holy Spirit is trying to cause you to become more and more with the knowledge you have about Christ from glory to glory. The more knowledge you gain about Christ, the more you become like Christ. Amen. The Holy Spirit works in us. He works in you as you yield to him. Ephesians 3:20. Now unto him. Somebody say, now unto him. That is able to do exceeding and abundantly and above all that we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. Can you shout hallelujah? Come on, give it another hand. You can shout hallelujah. I mean, there is a power that worketh in us. I could have never been a pastor for 40 years. Hadn't been for the Holy Spirit. 40 years I've been a pastor. I've been preaching 45 years. Never would have made it. Hadn't been for by the power of the Holy Spirit. Because that's sometimes, even before I was pastoring, I felt like giving up. That quitting. Because people can be hard. Do y'all hear me? They can be hard. They can be hard. But the reason men are hard, they just don't know no better. I was teaching years ago about that, and I was teaching at another church, and when I said, they just don't know no better, that one person shouted, they do know better. They just... I detected then that person had been hurt by somebody. But some people just don't know no better. And Jesus says some just don't know no better. At the cross, he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Didn't they? And he gave up the ghost. He gave it to his father. They put him in the grave. He stayed there 3 days and three nights. And the third day morning, he got up. With all power, heaven and earth in his hand. Can you shout hallelujah? That's one of the reasons we worship on Sunday, because it was the first day of the week. So it shouldn't be just waiting till Easter. Every first day of the week, we'll remember what Jesus did for us. Yes, he died, but he was buried, but then he got up early the third day morning with all power, heaven and earth in the hand. So every Sunday, we ought to be shouting as well as across the week. Jesus is not dead, he's alive. And he's well. Some people are alive, but they're not well. You know, I have some aches and pains, so I'm not complete there. Anybody have any pain? I have some pains, amen. Sometime I woke up in the morning and I said, boy, I wish I could stay right here, amen. You know the feeling. But then when I start moving, it's going to be on then. But anyway, I just want to encourage you to lean on the Holy Spirit. Keep sin out of your life. Don't say nothing out of God's will.
Amen.
You're not big enough to say what you want to say. You're not old enough to say what you want to say. You got to say what the Lord wants you to say. And when the Holy Spirit is in charge, he'll guide your every word. He'll guide all of your actions. He'll guide you to be pleasing to the Father, because he wants to shape you up and conform you to the image of God's Son. Oh, what a privilege to walk around on this earth, amen, and people can see in you the life of Jesus Christ. They can see you loving like he loved. They can see you forgiving like he forgave. They can see you helping like he helped people, amen. That's what he's trying to do. And sometimes, it gets kind of rocky, but you got to keep pressing. Choir's going to sing. If you're here this morning, if you're not saved, say yes to Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit will enter your life if you're truthful. And he'll start working in your life.